We just talked about leasing, where we talked about the four types of leasing and the economics of how to determine or choose between the purchase versus the lease. And today we're going to talk about debt. We're going to be looking at a comparison between loan terms, something we haven't talked much about other than how to calculate a fully amortized loan, the payment amounts, how to amortize it. But we haven't talked about how to choose between loans. So we're going to get into this area of cost of capital, and we're going to look at liquidity and the lease cost. We'll get into some more terminology in the cost of debt capital, such things as the actuarial rate or the annual percentage rate and the effective interest rate. Some of those terms you've already heard. For sure, the annual percentage rate, you see it quoted, and some of you may know how to calculate that, but we're going to delve into it precisely on how that is calculated. But we'll also cover methods of computing interest, such as add-on, discount, and the remaining balance method. Your reading assignment now is chapter 14. Okay, looking at the capital, you have debt and equity capital. In fact, if you remember in your accounting on the balance sheet, if you remember right, you have your assets that you control, but you have to finance those assets with what? Your debt plus your equity. The debt and the equity have different terminologies you have to get used to. You know, debt, you could call those liabilities. You know, the equity could be owner's equity or owner's net worth. You know, there's different ways of bringing those or referring to the debt and equity. But we're looking now at the financing side of the balance sheet. Now, in agriculture, access to equity is limited. Now, if you're Microsoft and you want to put in a new plant to produce more software for Windows, or you want another development area so you can continue to make a higher valued software, and they need the money to do that, and they want equity, what do? If you're Bill Gates and you want more money to expand your operations, and you want equity, how do you get equity? You just sell more stock. But how many farmers do you know that can go out and issue publicly traded stock? You're limited to the equity that you personally have, or the family has, or you might go into a partnership with one or more family members or a trusted friend, but there's a limit to that. So that your access to equity capital is limited in agriculture. The other thing is that equity holders are the residual claimants of profit. They're more risk than the debt holders. Now, there's something that we talked about at the very beginning of this course. The classic example of that is, you know, if you hold stock, you're in a much riskier position than the debt holders. Because if you're with a company like Enron, if you have stock in Enron and it goes under, you may get pennies on the dollar. Whereas the debt holders have first claim on any of those assets that might be in the company. The equity holders only get anything after all the debt holders that have claim on those assets are paid off. So there's obviously more risk associated with it. The cost of equity, then, we can think of as something higher than the cost of debt capital. Why? Because, as you know, that if you take on more risk, you have to be compensated for it. And we're going to cover that more in depth in lectures to come. It just simply stated is just that. If you take on more risk by owning equity, you expect a higher compensation. So thus, it's going to cost you more to get somebody to give you equity than the debt because you're putting them in a higher risk position. In this particular chapter and for this class, our focus is going to be on debt capital, primarily because the access to farm producers is limited to expansion through the debt capital. Given that as the overview, the idea is in personal finance or in business, when you're looking to expand and you need to borrow money, you look at different sources of debt capital. And you have to make comparisons as to look at which of those are going to be better. Do you go to Citizens First National or do you go to the Farm Capital Credit? Okay, or the host of other banks that may exist that can provide that capital. Who do you go to? And how do you make those comparisons between the alternative loan terms? In making that decision, we're going to group this into two categories. One, when we're making these comparisons, we want to look at liquidity. And the first segment of liquidity is down payment. And you recognize this. If you were to go buy a house right now or look to buy a house, I suspect that the amount of down payment that they require on the loan that you're looking at is important. Because if you have very little money in the bank, okay, you're not going to be able to put a 20% down. So you're going to have to find a loan or a lender that's willing to make 100% loans. And some will and some won't. On the other hand, you've inherited some money and you've got it sitting in your bank. You may want to put at least 20% down to avoid mortgage insurance. There's no firm decision that says you're looking for a down payment of 5% or 10% or 50%. The other issue is loan maturity. As you're comparing different loans, you may have one lender or maybe the same lender, but they're willing to give you one loan that's amortized over 30 years, and you have another loan that'll go over 15 years. Now, you know if you're going to pay that off over 30 years, you recognize that you're going to have to pay a lot more interest. But if you've purchased a house where it's maxed out, you know, that debt's maxed out what you can pay relative to your income, you may not be able to go to a 15-year note. Even though you'd like to save the interest, you may be in a liquidity position where you want to eat. So you may decide to go 30-year. On the other hand, if you're in a position, a stable position, with high income relative to your debt payment, then you may want to go 15-year amortization so that you don't pay as much interest. This last one doesn't fit very well to personal finance because most of the loans that you take out for a house or a car is going to be at the beginning of the month every month. But in agriculture, this is something that you need to consider because if you're making a payment on land purchases and it's once a year and you're trying to structure the liquidity of this loan, do you structure it so that you make that annual payment at the beginning of the planting season, or do you make it at the end of the harvest season? Okay, you're going to do it at the end of the harvest season where you have more cash surplus. Because if you do it at the beginning of the planting season where you're having to borrow short-term cash to even to get the crops planted, you'd end up having to borrow short-term money to pay off your land payment. In the businesses, this third element of repayment scheduling you need to pay attention to. The second category of comparing loans is the cost. And you want to choose the lowest cost interest. And you're going to choose the loan then with the least cost. And that's what we're going to focus on. If we do that, we need to account for the time value of money. We have to recognize the element of time when we're looking at the interest rate. Going through this process of the least cost, if we're going to compare two different loans and trying to determine which has the least cost, we have to have some decision criterion. We have to have some way to make that decision. If the conversion periods are the same, in other words, if you're looking at two loans that are compounded monthly, then you can use the actuarial rate or the annual percentage rate. Now, we're learning a new terminology, but the actuarial rate, you already know how to calculate because it's the yield on that loan or the internal rate of return, and you've calculated those. It's simply the rate that makes the present value of cash inflows equal to the present value of cash outflows. So we're learning a word here, but the procedure for calculating that rate, you already know how to do. You just have to put those two pieces together. Or you can also use the annual percentage rate, where the actuarial rate is converted to an annual rate. If, on the other hand, the conversion periods are different. Now, that doesn't happen very often, but it can happen. If you're looking at a loan that is compounded monthly versus a loan that is compounded annually, then the actuarial and the annual percentage rate don't give you the correct answers. Or they potentially can give you erroneous answers. In those cases, we need to use what's called the effective rate. The rule, of course, is we're going to choose the lowest rate. Something to consider in this, when calculating the decision criteria, we need to include the non-interest costs. For example, in the mortgage lending business, I've had people come and they say, you know, I quote them, I can make this loan at 6 1/8. And they come back and say, well, Citizen National is going to lend money at 6%. And I ask them, well, let's take a look at your good faith estimate. And frequently what they come in, and yes, their rate is down, but yet for the loan origination points, okay, they may be paying $5,000 or $6,000, where I don't charge anything. So they're paying a high price just to get a little lower rate. The point is that when you are looking, you can't just look at rates. You have to look at the non-interest costs associated with them. You know, if you hear an advertisement on TV that says, buy this furniture for 0%, you can bet that they're going to get their money in one place or another, usually in the price. If a lender is offering you an interest rate lower than the market rate, you can bet that they're getting that in some other place. You cannot just look at the rate. You have to factor the stated rate, the contractual rate. You have to also look at what we're talking about here in these non-interest costs. And I've got a very short list of those just to give you a flavor. Many banks will charge you some kind of a service fee. Many banks, certainly in the mortgage industry, will charge points. Now, points is prepaid interest. A point is the percentage point. And 1 point is 1% of your loan. If the lender requires that you pay 1 point, they're basically telling you that you're going to have to pay 1% of that loan at the very beginning, prepaid. Before you walk out the door with that money, you've already paid 1%. And on a $100,000 loan, which is a very typical house price, you're paying $1,000 up front in prepaid interest if they charge you a point. Okay, also, some lenders will require or charge fees for credit reports. You know, another interesting charge that you have to watch for is compensating balances. And you may have a credit union that's willing to lend you $12,000 for your new truck, and they're willing to lend that to you for 6%, good reasonable rate. But the clause says that you have to have $3,000 that is left in their credit union in CDs or deposits. And it so happens that they only pay 3% on that money. They're lending you money at 6%, but they're requiring you keep your money in their bank a certain quantity at a much lower rate. We call that compensating balances. That's okay, it's good business practice, but that has to be factored in when you make comparisons between another bank that offers 6.25% but don't require compensating balances. If instead of taking that $3,000 and leaving it in an interest-bearing account at 3%, why don't you buy down your car mortgage so that you're not paying 6% on that $3,000? So yes, you're earning money, but your opportunity cost is 3%, right? Another 3% that you're losing. You have to account for that when you're comparing loans. And the next item is stock requirements. That is required in the Farm Credit System. The Farm Credit System is the number two lender to production agriculture. And it turns out they're a cooperative. Who owns a cooperative? The members. So who owns the Farm Credit System? The borrowers. And so if you want to go borrow money from Capital Credit here in Bryan, if you want to buy a house outside the city limits, they will lend money to you. But what are you going to have to do? You got to buy stock in it. And it's a non-earning stock. It's not like compensating balance where they pay you interest. The stock in the Farm Credit System is non-earning. You don't get any interest on it or any dividends. When you're borrowing from the Farm Credit System, you can't just look at the rate. You have to also find a way to evaluate this foregone use of your money. Or in many cases, actually what happens is the borrower actually borrows additional money so that they can buy the stock, and they're paying interest on that money that they never received. It just means that you have to consider that when you're comparing a note from the Farm Credit System as opposed to a bank. And of course, there's a whole list of these types of expenses. And all of these have to be reported in a good faith estimate And those have to be considered and should be considered when you're comparing loans. You can't just look at the stated rate, because the stated rate can be quite different when you factor in all the additional costs. If you don't get anything else out of this, when you go to borrow money, it pays to shop. And I'll give you an example. When a client comes to me and asks me to price out a loan, and they tell me that they have already been to bank A, B, and C, and are getting quotes, when I actually give them a quote, what quote am I going to give them? The highest possible one or the rock bottom? I've got to go in, and I'm not going to make as much money if I want that business, because I know that they're competing. But if a person comes in and they don't know how to shop, or they don't care, they just want, you know what, they have perfect confidence, and they just ask one lender, which rate is that lender going to give them? Maybe not the highest, but they're going to extract a little bit more money, right? What's the moral of this? You shop. What we're leading into now is you have two different lenders, and one has a lower rate, but they have higher costs. How do you figure out which of those is better? You cannot just look at the contractual rate. You have to have a way of looking at the lowest cost, not just the lowest rate. And that's what we're getting into now as we talk about the actuarial interest rate. You already know how to calculate it. It's the yield on that loan. As I already mentioned, it's the rate that makes the present value of the cash inflows to that loan equal to the present value of the cash outflows. You got money coming in from the bank, you have to pay it back. And that's where you introduce the time value of money, and you know how to calculate that rate. Recognize that when you're borrowing money, okay, what's the cost of the borrower is profit to the lender. So we can think of it in that context of yield. It is required that all lenders report is the annual percentage rate. And the annual percentage rate is taking the actuarial interest rate, the yield on that loan, and multiplying it by the number of conversion periods to get the annual rate. For example, you may have a credit card in your pocket, and the monthly interest on that may be 1%. That's your yield, or that's your actuarial rate. And if you want to annualize that to get the annual rate, how do you do that? Well, there's 12 months in a year. You take that 1%, you multiply it by the 12 conversion periods per year, and voila, you have an annual percentage rate at 12%. It's that simple. Another quick example is a quarterly rate. If you have to pay 3% compounded quarterly, and there's four quarters per year that get the annual percentage rate, you multiply the 3% times the four quarters also to get the 12%. The effective interest rate, we said, needs to be used to compare loans that have different conversion periods. If you're comparing a loan that's compounded monthly as opposed to annually, to find the effective interest rate, let's take the interest paid during the year, all the interest that you paid during the year, and divide it by how much you borrowed. Pretty basic, right? Isn't that how you calculate an interest? Here's the dollar interest divided by how much you borrowed, and it gives you a percentage rate. And we call that the effective interest rate. Of course, it's annual. And so the effective interest rate is really pretty simple. The question is where we have multiple conversion periods per year, how do we calculate the total interest that is paid? And the way we do that is we take the initial amount that we borrowed, and we use the future value of a single sum of money formula to calculate how much we would owe the bank at the end of the year. And we would do that by doing 1 plus the interest rate, where the interest rate is the rate per period. And we get the rate per period by taking the annual rate and dividing it by the conversion periods per year. And that's really pretty simple, because if we had a 12% annual rate and it was compounded monthly, you take the 12% and you divide it by the 12 months, and you'd have a 1% per period rate. And then we would compound that over the number of conversion periods per year. If it's like compounded monthly, it'd be 12. So what we have in this first component of the numerator is how much money we would owe the bank at the end of the year. To calculate the interest, we simply subtract out how much we borrowed, and the difference is going to give us the interest. And then, of course, we divide all of that by the initial amount that we borrowed. You can see that this principal amount is in both components of the numerator, and it's also in the denominator. So from your arithmetic, you know that you can cancel those out, leaving the following equation. And that becomes then the formula for calculating effective interest rate. It turns out if you're compounded annually, in other words, if your conversion period per year is one, then your annual percentage rate is going to be the same as your actuarial rate, which is going to be the same as your effective rate. That piece of information can save you a little bit of time in your homework and possibly on an exam. If you're comparing loans and one of them is compounded annually, then you know that rate that you're using is your APR, your actuarial, and your effective rate, so you don't have to go through all the computations. Okay, a problem to help us maybe understand better why we use the effective interest rate. Let's suppose that you want to borrow $1,000 for just 1 year. The interest rate at Bank A is 12% compounded monthly. Or you can go to Bank B, and their rate's the same at 12%, but it's compounded yearly. The question is which loan has the least cost? Are you going to borrow from Bank A or Bank B? Both seemingly have the same annual interest rate. Okay, let's look at the loan balance at the end of the year. For Bank A, we're going to borrow $1,000, and because it's compounded monthly, we take the yearly rate and divide it by 12, which gives us a 1% rate. And because there are 12 months in the year, we compound it by 12. This is the basic future value of a single sum of money formula that we've been using for some time. We plug that into our calculator, and it means that we owe $1,126.83 to the bank at the end of the first year, part of it principal and part of it interest. The interest paid is $126.83, and we get that number by subtracting the 1,000 principal from the amount that we owe the bank at the end of the year, that difference, of course, being the interest. For Bank B, it's even easier because it's compounded annually. We take the $1,000 and we multiply it by 1 plus the interest rate, and 12% of $1,000 is $120, so the interest paid is $120. We owe the bank $1,120 at the end of the year, $1,000 in principal, $120 in interest. Okay, so which bank are you going to use? Which bank has the lowest interest cost? Okay, B, because we only owe the bank $1,120 at the end of the year, where we owe $1,126 for Bank A. No surprises on this, right? Because you understand about the compounding of interest. But now let's look at it in this chart, comparing the interest rate in Bank A and Bank B. The actuarial rate for Bank A was 1%. The per period rate was 1%. For Bank B, it was 12%. We calculate the annual percentage rate by multiplying the actuarial rate by the number of conversion periods. 1% by the 12 conversion periods per year is 12%. For Bank B, 12% times 1 is obviously 12%. So if we made the comparisons, based on the annual percentage rate, and this is the rate that is required by law that the lender provide to its customer. So in both cases, you walk into the bank, they say your annual percentage rate is 12%. So if that's the only information you use, which one do you go with? You're indifferent. But are you really? What did we determine? Bank B is better, but according to the APR, you'd be indifferent. So is APR the correct decision criteria to use when you have different conversion periods? And the answer is no. We have to look at the effective interest rate. And the formula for the effective interest rate that we have derived today is you take 1 plus the per period rate raised to the number of conversion periods minus the one. That's going to give us the effective interest rate for Bank A. Let's plug in those numbers. Okay, we said for Bank A that the annual percentage rate was 12%, and there are 12 conversion periods per year. That's going to give us a 1% per period rate. We raise that to the 12th power, subtract out the 1, and it'll give us the 12.68%. If we do the same thing for Bank B, the annual rate was 12%. There is only one conversion period per year. We subtract out the 1, and it gives us 12%. Now, if we take these two numbers, okay, for Bank A and Bank B, and complete our chart so that we have an effective interest rate, notice now that Bank A has 12.68 and Bank B has 12%. So now if we compare Bank A and Bank B using the effective interest rate, which do we choose? If you're borrowing money, it'd be Bank B, right? If you were saving and you're putting your money in that bank, the $1,000 in the bank for a year, then which would you go with? Bank A. If you're a borrower, you're going to go with Bank B. Bank B then has the lowest interest cost, and we have determined that not only intuitively, but also looking at it using the effective interest rate. Now let's talk about the methods for computing interest. There are some common methods for doing it: the remaining balance, the add-on, and discount. We're only going to focus in this class on the remaining balance. That's what's primarily used. But your text actually discusses the add-on method and the discount method. And those are important to understand, because before Congress required lenders to report the annual percentage rate, many of the car dealerships or other types of vendors would actually calculate interest based on add-on or discount. And I could show you, for example, that a car company could offer a 3% interest rate. If they used the add-on or discount method, that the annual percentage rate could actually be as high as 23%. What does that mean? An uneducated person looks at the newspaper and it says, buy this car at 3% interest rate, and they're real excited. They go in and buy the car, they sign the dotted line, but what they don't realize is how that interest is calculated actually gives returns to the lender a 23% return. That's why the Congress went in and passed a law that the lenders be required to report an annual percentage rate, so that when that person goes in and buys that car and signs the dotted line, it has to be reported on there the interest rate's not 3%, it's really 23%. So there's creative ways to calculate interest. Now that the lenders are required to do the annual percentage rate, the remaining balance method is what's typically used. And that's what we have used from day one in this class. And to formally present this, if we let P represent the principal or the remaining loan balance, and if we let this IC represent the annual contractual rate, and the big I, the uppercase I, the interest paid per period, and C representing the conversion period, so the notation is very typical. If we want to know how much interest we owe in a period, we're going to take the outstanding principal amount and multiply it by the per period rate. And how do we get the per period rate? We're going to take the annual contractual rate and divide it by the number of conversion periods. Nothing fancy here. We're just multiplying the outstanding balance by the per period rate. If you contractually had a 12% interest rate compounded monthly, what's your per period rate? You take the 12%, divide it by the 12 months, and you get a 1% rate. So we're not talking anything sophisticated here. This is also what's used in the fully amortized loans. This is embedded in the arithmetic of a fully amortized loan. Anytime you fully amortize the loan, okay, using those functions on your calculators to calculate payment, embedded in this is the interest calculated on the outstanding balance.